Although the Sex Pistols may have lit the punk rock flame, it was the Clash who over the years from 1976 to 1983 that carried the torch. Their albums from the 1977 debut, The Clash, through Give 'Em Enough Rope, London Calling, Sandinista and Combat Rock, set the standard and defined what punk rock was all about. Punk had made music fun again. It was simple to play if you had the desire, and impossible if you didn't. It was rebellious, angry, politically aware, and with a Clash involved, drop-dead stylish. At the heart of the Clash was Joe Strummer, the punk poet, the power plant at centre stage, the carburettor at full choke. In 1977, it was Strummer who wrote No Elvis, No Beatles, No Rolling Stones. But prior to this, he'd been in the legendary 101ers.
And we were kind of a hippie squat rock band, the 101ers. And punk polarised every... You were either for it or against it. And there's still people today that don't talk to me down in West London for going over to the other side, if you like. Finally, one night, the Sex Pistols showed up on the support slot. And that's just to see that go off in a pub. It was really shattering. That was why it was such an atom bomb, was it just blew all the other rubbish away. Because they didn't care whether you liked it or not. When you saw the Pistols, they didn't care whether people liked it or not. They were going to play it anyway, which was a great... That freed the music straight away. If you tried to explain to someone how you could pack everything in when you saw a group or a group would change your life, I don't know if it... In today's world, things have changed subtly. Punk rock definitely came out of a situation where there was nothing on the telly, nowhere to go, no shops to buy any gear in, nothing, zilch, so it was entertain yourself. And perhaps that's what gave it some kind of strength. I think the strength of the music is that any fool can play it. It's simple. It has low overheads, i.e. a drum kit and a couple of amps will make the scene. And it's fun. This is a big point. It's fun to play punk rock because it's very physical. It's not like needling at a computer or sewing or something. It's very physical. You get the guitar and you bash the guitar and so... And the noise comes out. It's very direct. I love it for its moronicness. I'm all for moronic behaviour, wherever possible.
To the establishment, punk's most moronic behaviour was gobbing, which basically meant spitting at the band. It's hard to understand now. Mind you, it was hard to understand then.
Now, gobbing at the gigs was started, they say, by Captain Sensible. So, not knowing the true facts, I bet they're right, though. I blame Captain Sensible without knowing why, but these poor Americans got the whole brunt of it. Because we just called up Richard Hell and the Voidoids and said, yeah, come on the tour, we're touring Britain, come on. And I didn't think to explain to them that gobbing was kind of big at that moment. And so they went out and they got gobbed on big time. And after a while, I began to realize it was quite good, really, because the audience were quite dry by the time we came on. I mean, you can't gob all night, can you? It connected you to that guy standing there, if you could land a good goz on his forehead. Yeah, then you had a Saturday night.
It was the band's visionary manager, Bernie Rhodes, who spotted Joe and his old band, the 101ers, giving him just 24 hours to make his mind up to join the Clash.
When we formed the group, Bernie Rhodes said to us, because Mick had some sort of dopey love songs, like 1, 2, I Got a Crush on You. I mean, kind of cute, but dopey. And so Bernie Rhodes said, well, why don't you write about the things that are affecting you, because prior to being a squatter, we tried to rent flats, and one night I got really done over by the Harlesden police. It was an illegal eviction. The landlord had bribed them to And I did take the case to court, but it got thrown out. But I did feel a little bit run under the wheels of the machine.
Joe's lyrical input to Mick Jones' songs was to form the basis of The Clash. Their coming together was one of the most important events in punk rock history, followed closely by the presence of the manager, Bernie Rhodes.
That's a huge bit of luck, to meet a writer that you can write with. And another bit of luck was being at the right place at the right time, doing the right thing. I mean, that's all jam, that. I really like the way I spent the weekend with Mick. Getting a set of lyrics onto a piece of paper, and I'd really battered away at this typewriter all day Saturday night and all day Sunday, and I'd whittled it down, and I had this lyric, and it was called White Man in Hammersmith Palais, and I took it to him, and within like 2 hours those words were floating on a melody, and I thought, this is great, because they'd been just two dimensional, you know, bam bam bam, and there they are, that, you know, they look good, they're working, and then they fly. I think that's songwriting, or, you know, that's like Rodgers and Hammerstein or something. Bernie Rhodes was very important, but more than Bernie Rhodes being important was it's the relationship between Bernie Rhodes and Mick Jones that dictated everything that happened to The Clash from the beginning to the end, because they wanted to work together, but they couldn't work together. They knew they needed each other, but they hated each other. And sometimes Mick would get rid of Bernie and then I'd bring him back. And we always had our best times, or our most successful forays was when Bernie was in charge. And he had a vision of culture. You know, we didn't scrabble around and get any group to support us. Bernie would get suicide in, from, you know, that was the first time many of us had seen a synth duo, you know. And this was Bernie's, he knew that it had to be a cultural event, that it was an important time, and he went to great lengths to make everything that, so that when you got involved with the whole thing, you felt you were getting information.
The strength of their songwriting partnership gave The Clash powerful momentum, a momentum dangerous at times to those who might stand in their way, like record companies or famous American producers.
I was aware that the company was rowing onto us an American producer for some reason, but we were going at such a juggernaut that we didn't care who this guy was. It wasn't going to derail the way we were going. And the fact the bloke got knocked out when he turned up to one of the shows, Sandy Pearlman, this is the Blue Oyster Cult producer, and Mick Jones's mate knocked him out at the gig, thinking that he was someone trying to come in the room. And Sandy stuck his head in, and Crocker went, "Look, mate, we're just getting ready to go on, all right?" And he pushed him back out, and then Sandy, like, knocked him, said, "But I'm the..." And Crocker went, "Look, mate, I told you." And blam! And then they shouted, "The producer's unconscious on the floor." We're all bending over again. Come on, man.
Pearlman recovered enough to produce 1978's Give Him Enough Rope. But it was to be the next album, London Calling, that would in later years top the critics' polls and open up the American audience to the band.
London Calling was a result of Bernie being banished. I think him and Mick had an argument. And so Mick got in these guys, Black Hill, who did Ian Dury and the Blockheads. Anyway, but it kind of, all of a sudden we were on our own, as if like Daddy had gone away. And so somehow we knuckled down. And every day for 5 months, we just rehearsed and wrote. And then recorded it at the end of that period. And there it was. But we didn't think we'd done anything brilliant. for somehow the Americans took to us. Like we hadn't done that many gigs really, but we'd done a bit of foot slogging around like Cleveland or whatever. But by that time, I think London Calling really opened up a lot of, because a lot of Americans at that time are going, hey, what is this punk rock? You know, what is this shit? And so they bought London Calling and went, whoa, that's not all crap. You know, they couldn't take the piss out of that.
London Calling through the faraway towns. Now war is declared and battle come down. London Calling to the underworld. Come out of the cupboard, you boys and girls. London Calling, now don't look to us. Phony Beatlemania has bitten the dust. London Calling, see we ain't got no swing except for the rain and the crunch of thing. The ice is coming, the sun's zooming in. Meltdown expected, the wheat is good thin. Engines stop running, but I have no fear, 'cause London is drowning.
Further albums followed, Sandinista in 1980 and Combat Rock in 1982. However, as the band settled into the realities of being a touring rock act, tensions between Mick and Joe reached breaking point, and Joe stunned Clash fans by firing Mick.
Mick was a bit pissed off with me for a while, you know, when I sacked him, but my defence is that I'd allowed, by him being such a miserable, grumpy guy, he'd allowed Bernie, who was back at this time, and we're back to what I said at the beginning, it's always, is Mick going to get rid of Bernie, or is Bernie going to get rid of Mick? And he'd allowed Bernie to sort of manipulate me. I mean, I take the blame for being manipulated, but it didn't help him being in a furious mood or throwing the sort of huge star in a huff ploy down so often, yeah? And so that enabled Bernie to leave me and Paul away, and the group smashed up there and then, that second. You know, me and Paul dragged it on for 18 months, maybe 2 years, but to all intents and purposes. And so my epitaph on it would be, and I'm quite angry about this, because I met Mick and Bernie as a team. They had already hooked up before I met Mick, and Bernie introduced me to Mick Jones. And so obviously anyone would make the assumption that these guys, hey, they're a team, they're working together, they're trying to do something. And 5 years later, you know, you discover that they're not a team. And then I started to feel that me and Tobba were the engine of the group, because we were standing in a line, that I'd be at point and he'd be at the drum kit. And we just used to make the rhythm, which just sort of come out of the middle of the stage. And like, it was quite nice. The other guys were like wingmen or flymen, you know, leaping around and doing their thing. But me and Tupper were like giving it the energy from the core. And that's when I realized that I'd been blessed by the gods to have someone to work with like Tupper.
Few had realized how important Tupper had been to the Clash, or indeed how his problems would so deeply affect the others.
Our problems started, as they all start, with drugs. Specifically heroin. When Tupper became addicted to that, I knew we'd had it, because it's great, well not great, but you can see for a saxophone player drifting across the top of the music, you've got a little leeway there, but the drum beat is so, it has to be there. And I don't think it's a great drug of choice for drumming. I mean, if you had to make some such silly compartmentalization, but it's perfect for alto saxophone players, you could say, but it sure is not good for drumming. And also, well, that was just maybe the sort of the visible part of the rot. The other part of the rot that you couldn't really see was, we're all very tired by that, by this point. Perhaps we'd done too many records, too many tours. No one ever suggested, hey, why don't you take a break? Or we were too stupid to think of that. Hey, you know, we made 16 sides of vinyl. Why don't we, like, have 6 months off or something? But instead, we were kind of going right back into doing another record, and that's what really... I don't think anyone's minds could take it. We burnt out, which is... I like to burn out. I think do your thing and throw it down and back off, you know. And strangely, success, or perhaps not so strangely, wasn't... We weren't able to handle it, because after all the years of struggle and intense effort, Rock the Casbah went top five in the States. And that seemed to blow us apart more than anything.
Hmm. For many looking back at punk, it's hard to understand the apparent naivety of the musicians. They appeared uninterested in contracts, small print, or indeed money. It's hard to explain except to say, you had to be there.
I don't regret anything about it, the forthrightness of the punk rock movement, because that was part of its nature, to be direct and forthright. I mean, the sillier it was, the better, really. In fact, the best period was when people would show up wearing toilet seats around their necks at gigs and, you know, omelets hanging from their shoulder blades. That was punk rock. The fun nature of it is that we'd romp in there like idiots and get chewed up by the machinery and spat out the back end. But it would be no fun if nobody romped in there, you know? In fact, you learn a lot about life getting shafted royally, yeah? If I could give any advice, I'd say, get into a position where you own your damn work, like the rights to the masters, the rights to the recording, the rights to the songs. Because that's the worst part of the whole scenario, when they rob you of that. Because that's really all you've got left at the end of the day. So I think with the internet and everything, people can be a little bit more intelligent. I mean, it's only stupidity. We can only blame our own stupidity. I mean, it's not rocket science to figure out what's in a contract, really, you know, even though they've got it very cleverly hidden. They've got us in the best possible bind. You want your music to go out to the world? Yes, yes. Well, sign there, you know. Who can turn that down? But we've certainly signed some stupid paperwork. Only a complete and utter fool would have signed these bits of paper. And we just went, yeah. Keith Richards said, don't sign anything. I knew that. I'd read that in an interview years before. Whatever you do, don't sign anything. Did it make any difference? Did it, heck? Because when you're hot, you're hot. That's the industry dictum, isn't it? So when you're hot, they're not really in the game of letting you fizzle out. You might fizzle out down on the farm. So it does seem cruel, because when you're hot, that means you're going to be really cold. The hotter you are now, the colder you're going to be sooner than, you know. So I'm just trying to roll along like warm. And I try to enjoy life and not get too grumpy about it. For me personally, when people come up and say, that changed this or that changed that, then you think, well, it was worth, or it got through, you know. Because some of the time you don't know, because sometimes it seems like gigs go in the wind. I mean, they're gone in a puff of smoke. But people remember. For example, we went to play The Big Day Out down in Australia, okay? And at the end of the tour, I had my wife and my stepkid with me. She's about 8. At the end of the tour, we got in the back of the plane, right? And she was going, huh. Like, she was just winding me up. if only you could have formed Clamp Class. Like that, worried about. I was going, shut up, learn to live in the back here. And the steward came up and he went, aren't you Joe Strummer? And I went, yeah. And he went, I was in the front row at the Electric Circus in Manchester on the 4th of April, 1977. And it was the so fantastic show. I'm upgrading you all immediately to Clamp Class, or whatever it was.
After a period spent with the Pogues, Joe has at last a new band, the Mescaleros, who aren't afraid to play the occasional Clash song and to take a relaxed view on world domination, etc.
I reckon that we're going to play the gig tonight. But beyond that, I'd keep your money in your pocket, mate. You know, I like to see things like that, you know, because it allows things to develop rather than trying to hold one rut where it might not be such a great road to take or whatever. I like just to, you know, if we've got the spirit and the wherewithal, we'll cook up a record. But if not, it might splinter. But I think tonight, although I wouldn't put my money down on the table yet, because the gear's in the theatre and the boys are sound checking, I think odds on we'll play the show tonight, yeah.